welcome everyone to Windsor Stadium for this rare spectacle. Intercollegiate action between the Windsor Fratmen taking on Geneva College, a Division III team out of Pennsylvania. Welcome everyone, Brian Thompson, joined by the head coach of the Essex Ravens, Mr. Glenn Mills. And Glenn, this is quite the game. We don't often see NCAA teams coming over here to play some Canadian versus American football.
No, you know what? It should be interesting. This Geneva team, just looking over the roster, look like they got some football players. So this should be a fantastic contest tonight.
For those watching, of course, AKO in their traditional black jerseys with gold trim. Geneva College out of Pennsylvania, they are in the white jerseys with the black helmets, so black on black helmets. It's some modified rules, of course, Canadian-American rules, everyone knows is different, but to play this game, both teams will get to play the rules they're accustomed to when on offense. Glenn, talk about how that plays to both teams' advantages here.
You know what? No, it definitely benefits both teams. I mean, AKO is used to playing with 12, obviously. Their offense runs with 12 guys, so it's going to be, it'll be much advantage for those guys. The American guys aren't going to be used to the motion and different things like that. So it's going to be tough beat both ways.
So to explain these rule differences, both teams, when they are on offense, will play to their normal country rules. It will be 12-on-12 when the Windsor Fratmen have the ball, and it will be 11-on-11 when Geneva College has the ball. Also, we will have no yard difference like they normally do in Canadian football. It'll be helmet on helmet. And as well, most kicks, I believe, will not be taken. We'll see sometimes they will opt to just take the ball from the 35. So, and also, regardless, it is four downs on both times. So those accustomed to Canadian football, it's a bonus for these teams getting an extra set of downs. And, of course, since this exhibition, this is a chance for the AKO Fratmen to get a chance to see what these new recruits are made of.
Yeah, like I said, it should be really interesting. AKO, you know, they'll get an extra down every time, which for those guys will play. I think a big advantage for them defensively. The American team could at Geneva College could have some difficulty with the wide field. You know, it's a little bit different coverages and things like that. So it'll be interesting to see.
The only exception to shortly. Geneva College, of course. Us in Windsor are very familiar with NCAA. Geneva College, though, out of Division III there in the National Christian College Athletics Association. They play in the President's Athletic Conference. Of course, a 2-8 record last year, and it's been a little bit since they've been in their bowl system. Of course, Division II and III down there, they play a traditional tournament style as opposed to the normal bowl system. The Tornadoes will be kicking from right to left on your television screen. Kicking will be number 7, Noah Wirtz, the sophomore.
And in to kick the ball for Geneva is number 7, Noah Wirtz.
We have Austin Crum and Tyler Story deep, both fantastic return guys.
We are underway here at Windsor Stadium. Ball taken by Crum, going on the right side. And they'll stop the play. A couple players slipping up, I'm not sure what the call is there, and we'll see the offense getting underway here. So Austin Lumley will come out for quarterback. Of course, been the quarterback the past couple years for the Fratmen. They're looking for their fourth OFC title this year, later on in the season. Of course, all those games will be happening here on WE TV. Such under center.
Fratmen come out of our eye formation, quick dive to Cody McCann, and absolutely no gain.
Cody McCann in his fifth year now for the Fratmen. Absolute juggernaut last year, helping them in that championship game over the Ottawa Sooners. Second and 10 now here. Flip receivers. Lumley just hands it. But nowhere to go as Jacoby Jones brought way back in the backfield, and they'll be third and long.
Going to be 3rd and 13 here for the Fratmen. This defensive line is dominating the line of scrimmage right now. They can't do anything up front.
Some big boys on this Geneva College team.
Get the starting O-line together right now.
Once again, Lumley in shotgun, two receivers to his left. Of course, motion is okay, and this is a pass to Jones and an absolutely devastating hit, well short of the first down.
Yeah, number three, Tim Martin come up and he just laid a vicious hit on Jacoby.
So Clark Green will be in to punt for the Fratmen. Going deep for Geneva College will be Joe Shively and Zach Hall. As it looks like they're going to switch balls out. As a coach, you know how imperative it is to get a K ball.
Yeah, absolutely.
Of course, both teams using this mainly as tape for when it becomes time for their training camps, the main camps.
Got a fair catch here by number 19. Good. Zach Hall, so they're going to start off around...
About the 40-yard line.
Yeah, right, close
closer to 35.
Yep,
they place the ball on the 35.
30-yard line.
So now it'll be time to see what the offense can do here for Geneva College.
First down.
It looks like in at quarterback is Noah Wirtz. Wirtz under center. Split receivers, tight end in motion. He likes to just hand it off. And it'll be 5 yards on the play and bring up second down.
Yeah, Geneva's in a little bit of a wing offense. It looks like going to run some power football, maybe some option by the setup. Got a solid O-line.
Three receivers, two Wirtz's left. Man motion, looking for the option. He likes to keep it, some big hits. But the Fratmen push him up a little bit and it'll be third and close. Looks like third and one here.
Third and one.
Coach, in an exhibition game like this, of course, you want to try out different things here.
Absolutely. I think you're going to see a variety of different formations, probably, a good rotation of people in there just to take a look at everybody going into camp.
Jamin Evans lines up on the left side. Wirtz just with the quick handoff. They push the line up. And it's about a gain of 7. An easy first down there for the Tornadoes.
Just a quick pop up the middle by their lone tailback or fullback for a big gain. Solid gain, 6 yards.
A lot of new faces in for the Fratmen right now as they finish up their week-long camp they've been having. First and 10 here from the 45. And it looks like we have an offside call here on the Fratmen. So, yep, it is offside. And we'll get a first and 5 here.
5 yard penalty on the Fratmen. First down.
So we'll see what the Tornadoes do here with short yardage situation. They close it up on the line with just one wide receiver wide. Quick handoff there to Trey Marshall, and Trey Marshall just bulldozes his way for a first down. Good run there.
Actually, a little bit of a zone. It was a little bit of a quarterback lead. It looked like a dive, but the quarterback pulled it and just followed him up the hole. This quarterback is quite the athlete. Big, strong kid that can run the football.
10:20 remaining here in this first quarter. We're expecting to get rain intermittently throughout the night, so we'll see how this field holds up here at ancient old Windsor Stadium. First and 10 here. Where it's handoff, and Marshall just going towards his right, but a good job trailing by the Fratmen. Tackle made there by Dalton Gilmore, and it'll be second down. Second and 8 here for the Tornadoes. They'll line up on the right side. Split receivers. And a bit of a slip there by Noah Wirtz. This turf has been slippery. It's been raining off and on since about noon today. And not much of a filtration system here at Windsor Stadium, so you're going to see that from time to time here.
Yeah, it was their first pass attempt, and it didn't go too well. He slipped and went down, and Hoyan Choi got the sack.
So third and 15 here. Wirtz will stay under center. It looks like they're playing a little conservatively. It's going to be another pass, though. Wirtz escapes to his right, throws it middle of the field, and just overthrows his man Harrison Koslow. And it'll be fourth down here for the Tornadoes, and no punt. Andrew Dowler will be taking the punts here for Geneva College.
We have Tyler Story and, again, Austin Crum deep. Again, both very, very solid return guys. This should be good.
Both men down at about the 17-yard line. Good kick could be received, and doesn't look like they're allowing returns here in this exhibition tilt. Of course, when it's an exhibition, you can modify the rules all you want to give players a different chance and see what looks what.
That's probably a good thing. You don't get to practice a lot of the stuff while you're in mini camp, and a lot of the injuries come off those special teams, so it's probably a wise idea to just to keep your guys healthy.
Especially in these wet conditions. So they'll place the ball on the 25 here. As the referees sort out, having to switch up now, it's 12 on 12 again. And they switch balls here too.
Yeah, the American balls they're probably using is probably a little bit smaller than a regular CJFL ball or an OUA ball.
Lumley in shotgun, just tosses it to his right. Good catch there by Hayes Williams. And Hayes Williams gets down the sideline. It'll be really close to a first down here.
He's got the first.
And we got a flag after.
You're probably looking for not, because I think, this penalty is going to bring it back to very close to the original line of scrimmage.
Penalty happening well after the play ended, so you're most likely looking on sportsmanlike.
That's what it's going to be. Yeah, I think it's going to be on Omar, the young man who made the reception.
So a bit of a trash-talking call is going to take his catch all the way back. So all we did was knock about a minute off the clock. Clock resumes. It's just a little bit over 8 minutes left here. four receivers for the Fratmen. Lumley goes under center. Just hands it off to McCann, and McCann struggles for a few yards.
Yeah, this D-line is, they're coming off the football. It's a big difference when you have that, without that 1 yard. They're right on you, and it's a much, much more difficult game.
They rule a gain of three, so it'll be second and seven here. Ball at the 31-yard line. As the rain so far staying away here at Windsor Stadium. Lumley, shotgun with two men back. Guy's in motion, he's got four receivers to his left. Makes the quick throw, it's caught. And just eaten up in the backfield. A good catch there by Jacoby Jones. See what this flag is.
That's a great job rallying to the football for this Geneva team. They had three, four guys getting out there real, real quick and, you know, just gang tackling.
Referee today, Todd Whited.
This is going back. This is a block in the back. This is going to be backed up.
Get the rest of the crew out. Umpire is Brent Webster. Chris Patton is the head linesman. Kirk Hayes, the deep umpire. Joe Cooper, the side umpire. Joe Schroeder, the back umpire. John Dodson, the line judge. And working the sticks today is Corey Cousins, Bill Ganton, and Norman Conte. So the ball will be placed at the 26-yard line. It is second and seven. Or second and long, rather. Second and 17. Lumley looking deep. Another flag out, and that is intercepted. Tim Martin intercepting.
That's a great job by number three. It's fantastic coverage. I don't know if they're going to. It may call this interference, but that was a fantastic job by that young man. They got tangled up a little bit.
On Windsor, so they decline that penalty, and they will take over.
Penalties right now definitely causing some problems for Windsor. That was a penalty-filled third drive there.
The ball is on their own 50-yard line. First down.
So Geneva will take over on their own 50-yard line, something they don't get to say very often.
They're in this same bout, this wing offense.
And it's Devin Koloski under center now.
They love to seem to attack the right-hand side running the football. I don't know if they got a stronger side or whatever, but they're definitely attacking the Fratman's left.
Trey Marshall gets 5 yards on the play. And Devin Koloski, who played wide receiver last year, he's in his senior season for the team, getting some shots under center. One receiver to his left with three in the backfield. Simple handoff. And another good run there by Trey Marshall. Tripped up a bit at the line, but he makes a great second effort, and it'll be close to the first down. It'll be third down. .525 remaining here in this first quarter. Koloski now with receivers to both sides. Harrison Coslow to the right. Look for Trey Marshall again, right behind center. And sure enough, they hand it right to him.
Quarterback pulled it again, and it was just a quarterback lead.
Excellent
first
fake.
Down.
Excellent fake. It'll be a couple yards ahead of the first down marker, and they will move the ball. Second time today they've been inside Fratman territory.
Very safe offense here by Geneva. I've only attempted one pass so far.
K keep everyone bunched up at the line here. Koloski keeps it on the option and gets wrapped up in the backfield. Excellent tackle by Dalton Gilmore. And that'll be a big loss. But it looks like Chris Grondin slipping on the play there. He looks to be okay. Second and 14 now coming up. Receivers all to Koloski's right. And pitch to the outside. It's going to Colin Kendrick. Kendrick breaking, getting past his men. A big gain there by Kendrick for the first down. Excellent run.
A little bit of a power pitch. A couple guys leading. And he got around the corner.
See where they place the ball. Ball spotted at the 35-yard line. Or 25-yard line, sorry. With just under 3 minutes remaining here in this first quarter. Koloski with two receivers to his left. Once again, another inside handoff.
It's that quick, that little quick pop again to the fullback, or to the actually the only back there.
They certainly get their reps in with these quick handoffs to Trey Marshall. Another first down here. Geneva's offense running on all cylinders so far to start this game. As Devin Koloski will get some last minute instructions from the sidelines. Of course, normally at the stadium, both teams would be on the same sideline, but for today, AKO will take the opposite sideline. Koloski under center. Fakes the inside handoff, decides to keep it himself, but he's wrapped up in the backfield. Good play by Adam Slickbauer, and keep him right around the line of scrimmage. It'll be second down.
I think it was a little bit of a mishandoff, and the quarterback just decided to keep it and run with it.
So it'll be second down here. So we're just under a minute 30 left here in the first quarter. Koloski back under center with two receivers to his left. Jamin Evans hasn't come into play yet. We're waiting to see if he gets the ball. Flag on the play. As Koloski keeps it for himself and not much doing on the play. We'll see what that flag is, though.
AKO did a nice job stringing that out to the sidelines, and it's going to be a very short gain. Looks like they're about the five, but this is coming back, I think, for a hold.
No, it is offside once again on the Fratmen, second time today now.
So this is going to be a second automatic five-yard gain here, and it's going to be a repeat second down.
Clock stopping with 58 seconds remaining.
And it looks
So now first and goal here, or second and goal. Koloski once again with that inside handoff, giving it to Colin Kendrick, and winds up just short of the end. They rule touchdown?
No, I think he gets knocked down about the 1 yard line, somewhere around there. Actually, maybe about the 3 yard line, 2 yard line.
One of the back judges was signaling touchdown. We were wondering what that was about. So this should be the last play here, the first quarter. And they'll just elect to end the first quarter here. So a scoreless first quarter between the Windsor Fratmen and Geneva College here on WE TV. So when we come back, we will resume the second quarter of Geneva and the Windsor Fratmen scoreless here at Windsor Stadium. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the second quarter. It says it's second quarter. 2 seconds left here in the first quarter, though. And it's a touchdown for Geneva College. Inside handoff there, and it was Trey Marshall on the touchdown. We think that was still the first quarter. No, Wirtz will come in for the extra point. Up and good. So Geneva College first on the scoreboard here. And now they rule at the end of the first quarter. The confusion ends, so when we come back, we mean it this time. It'll be the second quarter. It is Geneva College 7, the Windsor Fratmen none. You're watching the AKA or Windsor Fratmen here on WE TV. All right, welcome back here to the second quarter between Geneva and the Windsor Fratmen. Brian Thompson alongside with head coach of the Essex Ravens, Mr. Glenn Mills.
Geneva just setting up for a kickoff here. We got Tyler Story and Austin Crum deep.
Noah Wirtz, who was quarterbacking a little bit earlier for the... For Geneva will now kick.
This Noah Work seems to be doing all kinds of duties today. Nice kick.
Kick be taken by Tyler Story, but just for ceremonial purposes. And Austin Lumley will lead the Fratmen offense back onto the field. See if they can answer on that touchdown. So Jacoby Jones in at running back. Of course, this Fratmen team has a lot of rushing to lead up to. Cody McCann also in the game. He took a majority of the carries last season. Lumley in shotgun. Low snap. Throws it midfield. Great catch there by Hayes Williams. And about 25 yards on the play into Tornadoes territory, and that's a first down.
Little play action pass there to kind of slow down the defensive line.
Ball placed at the 50-yard line. Lumley sending last-minute instructions to Dallas Bowe. Got three receivers to his left. And the Fratmen have to call a timeout. Here's some confusion in the backfield.
Hey, fans, don't forget the concession stand is open.
Well, while we have time, Coach Mills, of course, your season will be starting up soon. How is camp going for you guys?
You know what? We're pretty happy with where we're at right now. We got lots of depth and lots of talent. We open up. We got about 10 days. We open up in London. And that should be a great contest for us. But you know, it's going to be. I think we're going to have an exciting season.
Of course, your home opener is in just a few weeks, is it not?
It is. It's going to be June 4th. We're going to open up our home opener will be against Niagara, which will be another outstanding football game.
And the Fratmen will open up, I believe, in late August with their opener. We'll get you a schedule in the second half of course, all the games you can catch here on WeTV. When they move back to their home at La Jeunesse. Another low snap. Lumley rolling out to his left. Tosses it. And good second effort there by Story. Jumping up and then securing the ball inbounds. And that is another first down for the Fratmen.
Awesome. You got away with a little one there as Austin was over the line when he delivered the football. But, hey, if they don't see it, it still counts.
Lumley twice, though, catching those low snaps.
They're having a little bit of difficulty with the snap. He's got to go real, real low, and it's causing a little bit of problems for him.
Under center for the Fratmen is number 65, Tom Livingstone. So now we'll see what he can do with shotgun. McCann to his left, another low snap. Delivered deep downfield, just out of the hands, but they're gonna rule pass interference. Back judge looking at pass interference. Tyler Story was the intended receiver on the play, and I believe that was number 15, Joe Shively.
Actually, I think it was number 19, Zach Hall, just kind of threw his hands up, really didn't make any attempt to make a play on the football, and he's gonna get called here. Now this happened in the end zone.
Yeah, it is pass interference against the Tornadoes. Yet is back to the play. So the ball placed on the 18-yard line with just over 13 minutes remaining here in this first quarter. Lumley in shotgun. Got McCann rolling to his left. Lumley just going to keep it, going upfield, using McCann as a blocker, going around to his left, and just sinks down at about the 11-yard line. Great effort by McCann reading the defense there to run up.
That's a great job by Austin, just, you know, using his feet to escape. Using the feet to escape.
.12:40 remaining here in the second quarter. Lumley going under center, two receivers to his right.
I formation.
And a bit of a fumble on the ball.
I believe they lost the football. No, they got it back.
Well, Lumley keeps the ball landing on it.
They're definitely having some issues with the handoffs and the snaps here. And it's this drive especially. I don't know if the ball may be getting a little bit wet right now.
Mm-hmm.
And it's causing a little bit of problems. But they're having some issues.
Still workable here, though. It is third down and seven. So two receivers to each side.
A little bit of a pistol look, shotgun pistol look.
McCann and Broad in the backfield. Broad moving to his right side. Lumley throws to his right. Caught there by Hayes Williams.
He's going to have...
That's going to be close.
He's going to have the first, I think. He's inside the five-yard line, so I believe he's going to have the first down here.
Referees move the sticks right away, so...
Right on the five, so this is going to be first down.
First down here and goal on the five.
Ball's on the five-yard line, first and goal.
Just over 11 minutes remaining here in this second quarter. Lumley getting last-minute instructions from Coach LaChance.
AKO right away from the run game right now, just play action, throwing the ball a little bit, keeping these guys off balance. They've had a little bit of success so far.
Hayes Williams, single receiver to the right. Four receivers in motion to the left. Lumley running to his left, looking for an open man. Sidearms it, throws it, caught, touchdown! Fratmen! Tyler Story hauls it in. And with 10:41 left here in the second quarter, the Fratmen are on the board.
Austin Lumley doing a great job again, getting outside the pocket and using his feet to create a little bit of time and delivers a great ball to Tyler Story.
Brandon Ream will be in for the hold and Clark Green in for the kick. And in an exhibition like this, you're not going to see much of an effort to block the extra point. Kick down, up, and good. So we are all level here with 10:41 remaining here in the second quarter between the Windsor Fratmen and Geneva College Tornadoes. Good offensive outing there by the Fratmen there, Coach.
Today's game is brought to you by Windsor Honda, where they want your next vehicle to be a Honda. Exclusive sports performance, Vito's Pizzeria.
Of course, reminder, check us out at we-tv.ca for a list of upcoming events. Of course, we will have some Junior B lacrosse, the Windsor Clippers. We'll be taking on Six Nations as well as other exciting games. And, of course, baseball season not too far away. So keep an eye out at we-tv.ca for all the latest games. So some kickoff practice going to happen now. As it goes down to 11 men. We'll see how far Clark Green can knock this. Here's a kick. And Green all the way back to about the 15-yard line. So they'll place the ball up on.
Looks like it's going to come to the 45, 35-yard line. Let's see if Geneva comes out in this wing offense again, if they're going to open this thing up a little bit.
Back in at quarterback is Noah Wirtz. Wirtz rolls to his right, he's being chased. Pitches it off. Good catch there by Trey Marshall. And he'll get brought down at about the 47-yard line and a first down here for the Tornadoes.
Noah did a real nice job getting outside there. He was in hot pursuit. Thought he was going to get sacked from behind, but he did a fantastic job getting rid of the football.
Ball's on the 47-yard line.
Where it's now is split receivers. Marshall in the backfield. A little bit of an audible at the line there. And he likes to keep it for himself. First down and more. Goes down to about the 43 and back-to-back first downs.
First down, Geneva.
This young man is a solid football player. He's a big, strong kid that can run the ball fairly well. Not afraid to get in there and mix it up with guys either. He's put together.
Now he's got the size for a quarterback to get inside that line.
Ball's on the Fratmen 43-yard line.
It'll be first down here at the 43 with 9 minutes remaining here in the first half. Pitch the outside, caught by Marshall. And he breaks through on the line. He'll be taken down by Matt Chamberlain.
Number six is Trey Marshall. He's a load too. Like, he had some problems bringing this young man down.
He's taking the majority of the carries, but he'll come off now for a breather.
Geneva, is their offense is definitely a ball control type offense. They don't take many chances. And
go with one receiver to the right. And another keeper.
He's going to be very close. I think he's going to be just short of the first down here. Nope, they're going to give it to him. Sorry.
Coach, you've played a few of these exhibition games. They're running a lot of the same plays. Is that normal?
You know what? I'm surprised, actually. Most of the time when we do it, we try and mix it up. We'll come out in one series, one offense, another series, another offense, just to get a look at a group of guys and in different things and see what we do well and what we don't do well. They've stayed in this kind of a wing offense, running the football almost the whole first half here. They haven't done too much. I think they've thrown two passes, which is a little bit surprising for an exhibition game.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe the second half they'll come out and start winging this thing around.
Wirtz once again on the keeper, and Fratman's got this well scouted now.
They're taking away that inside run. You're probably going to see option come very, very soon. He's going to pull this thing and get outside, and that's where it's been causing a little bit of problems.
So second and five here. The ball on the 28-yard line. Trey Marshall in the backfield. Once again, just one wide receiver to the right. They're keeping it conservative. But a timeout called by Geneva. A bit surprising there. So 6:29 remaining here in the second quarter of this tie game.
Well, I want to take a moment to apologize to all the Geneva fans. I just had a correction. The quarterback wearing number 7 is David Ellis. My score sheet was giving me incorrect information, so I want to thank the Geneva fans for bringing that to my attention, and we'll keep it straight for the rest of the game.
Sure, blame the score people.
Mark. Who?
The quarterback's name is Javid Ellis.
Javid?
J-A-V-I-D.
Okay, because I have a Javin Evans, too. So it turns out we've been calling the quarterback the wrong name the whole time. Number 7 here. As in most American colleges, you can have a player wearing the same number on offense and defense. That is Javid Ellis wearing number 7. As he elects to keep the ball, run to his left. Got a flag on the play. We'll see what that is. But a good run there by Javid Ellis, coach.
That's it. And this is going to be an offside. So this is a free play. I don't know how close they are to the first down, but this is going to be a first. They're going to move this up 5 yards. No, they got the first down, so they're going to take the play and move this thing up. I think the AKO, I think some of these guys are lining up offside, because as soon as that ball is snapped, that flag is going, and I don't see any movement, so I think they might be lining up in the neutral zone.
So they place the ball on the 20. Almost dead center field. Ellis with split receivers. Harrison Coslow to his right. Inside handoff.
A quick pop again to number 6.
Trey Marshall.
Trey Marshall. He's getting the hard yards, I'll tell you that.
He's earning it. Just a few yards on the play there. It'll be second down and 7 to go. So they like to go back to their normal formation with just one wide receiver to his right. Javin Evans is a lonely person out there at wide receiver today. Just the one throw so far. As Trey Marshall takes the inside handoff, gets through two tackles and touchdown, Geneva College.
Is running that inside zone again, and he has an option. The quarterback has an option to pull it or give it, and he's doing a great job on the read, and he just took that, a little bit of a kind of an off-tackle run.
Second touchdown for the offense today. for Geneva. Neil Harrison will come in for the extra point. Kick is up. And it's good. So 14-7 with 5:05 remaining here in the first half. As we'll see another kickoff without any touch. We had the fortune of sitting next to the Geneva coaches here up in the booth.
It's fresh. It's innovative. It's WeTV.
Taking this game very seriously. With their calls, of course. Fratmen, of course, getting some good game filming here, and they'll be using this throughout much of their off season as they gear up for their defense of their OFC title.
And now, to be accurate, Noah Wirtz in Kick the Football.
So now the real Noah Wirtz will be in. High kick taken at the 20-yard line. And we got some shoving over on the Geneva side. It only takes your first meeting to build a bit of a rivalry there. So now we'll see with just over 5 minutes what the Fratmen can do here. Is Austin Lumley getting some last minute instructions here? And we go back to 12 on 12. Lumley will go in shotgun.
Doing that pistol look with Cody McCann at tailback now instead of fullback. Come off with a
hand off to McCann. Breaks to his right. Being held back, but gets through two tackles. A good effort there by number 15, Joe Shively, to make the tackle. But McCann is, just like we saw a lot in the past year, he can break those tackles and get just those couple extra yards, and they make all the difference. Ball spotted right around the 40-yard line. So it'll be second down and four here. Split receivers, two on each side. And once again, it's to McCann. He hits that wall, though, and
there is no, there
the size
is no
of that
inside there. That defensive line is doing a great job with that inside inside stuff, and no, they're not giving up any yards.
So it'll be third and about four here, or three, rather. We'll see if the Fratmen can push this for a first down. With 3:35 remaining here. Lumley running to his right, looking deep, wide open receiver, caught for a first down, and the momentum takes it down with him. Catch on the play by Dallas Bowe.
They did a fantastic job on that little bit of a play action there, and Austin rolled out, and the defensive end completely, thought the ball was a run and shifted down the line and let Austin get outside there, which the wide receiver was wide open.
Couple substitutions here as Dallas Bowe comes off. Since it's Canadian offense, we hear a 3-minute warning. Wonder if we'll get a two-minute warning also. It's only fair. Lumley at shotgun. And the inside handoff there to Landon Porter goes absolutely nowhere for second down.
Yeah, this defensive line is coming off the football, and they're definitely, you know, causing some problems for the AKO offensive line.
Coming to the game now is Tyler Story. He'll check in for Landon Porter. Second down with 2:30 remaining here. Once again, Lumley staying in shotgun. Looks up midfield, and oh, that was almost picked off in two different ways. They'll stop the clock with 2:13. It'll be 3rd and 11. Bit of a dangerous pass there, Coach.
Yeah, it definitely was. He was in the middle of a group of people, and like you said, it should have been picked off probably a couple times.
So we'll see what Coach LaSange digs up here in his playbook.
Probably going to see him roll out and get outside the pocket. He's had some success when he gets outside and rolls him outside. They don't do a great job containing the edge.
Two men in the backfield. And it's going to be a pass. It looks to his left. Up in the air, caught, touchdown, Windsor Fratmen. Tyler Story, his second touchdown of the game.
That's a great job. They sent motion across and they isolated Tyler on the young man out here, and Tyler probably had about a 6-inch height advantage and just out-jumped him for the football. A little isolation play by with the receiver, and Tyler makes it count.
Great job there, getting to the goal line and establishing position. And for the second time this game, the Fratmen answer right back after allowing a touchdown, scoring right away. So an uncontested extra point here for Clark Green. Brandon Rehm in for the hold. Kick is up, kick is good. And some kids get the honor of catching the ball. So with 2:07 remaining here, the Windsor Fratmen 14, Geneva College 14. This is going pretty well for the Fratmen, I'd say, Coach.
You know what, they're having some success passing the football. You know, and that's what they do, right? I mean, playing a three-down league, so they're definitely doing what they do well, and but they're gonna have to improve their front run blocking up front if they're going to, you know, probably move towards their fourth consecutive title.
So now we switch back to 11 on 11. As Clark Green will just put it up. And they switch out the balls here again. As the rain's starting to come down just a little bit, we got a squib kick up the middle. And the play is blown dead. So why not give the squib kick a try? Kick returned by Zach Hall. How's that going to work if there's an onside kick at the end of the game? You catch it and blow it dead? They don't want the players touching each other here.
No, that's it. It's funny, in the U.S., when you have to squib kick it in order to do an onside, you can't like a high sideline kick because they can fair catch it.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a big difference for Canadian kids.
So 2:05 left here. Geneva College taking over.
Coming and back in the same offense.
Devin Koloski back under center for the Tornadoes. Just one man in the backfield. And he hands it off to Trey Marshall. Marshall breaks the tackle, but good tackle on the play there by number 99, Adam Slickbore. And at most, there's a yard there. So it'll be second down and 9. Coach Morency giving some instructions to his defense. It's a big offensive line, too, for Geneva College. Kowalski keeping it, run to his right. We might see a throw. He does throw it, but he throws it to the sidelines and out of bounds. Only the second throw by my count on offense here for the Tornadoes. So it'll be 3rd and 9 here for Geneva College.
I'm surprised, you know, with the situation in the game, they're not spreading out a little bit and open up this offense a tiny bit, but they're staying in this, like, kind of a double wing set, and they're going to try and run the ball and do stuff out of this double wing set.
Checking into the game for Geneva College is Harrison Coslow. So they'll go with two receivers to the right with Trey Marshall in the backfield. Fratmen yelling pass, but it is a pitch to the outside. Flag on the play. It'll be close here. Byron Stafford on the run, but we'll see what that call is. And it is a hold on Geneva College. So this is coming all the way back, and we'll replay 3rd down.
Yeah, this is going to be 3rd and just under 20.
That's an optimistic way to look at it. Our referee crew making the long walk north. And they place it all the way at the 26-yard line. And at 27 left here in the first half.
Be interesting to see if they come out of this double wing, but I don't think they're going to. No, they're coming right back out in this thing. They're not even going to attempt to spread it out to throw the ball a little bit.
Trey Marshall in the backfield. And Kowalski keeps it. Oh, and he's brought way back in the backfield. Big sack on the play. Chris Grondin. And Geneva College forced to punt here, and perhaps the Fratmen can score something before this first half ends. Great sack on the play by Grondin. Punt by Andrew Dowler. Now we're seeing that special teams contact they're trying to avoid. Windsor Fratmen will take over, though, and just around the 45-yard line. So with a 1:08 left, of course, it's just an exhibition game, but what would you be running here, Coach?
You know what? I'd stick to what got me 14 points, and I'd probably come out and throw the football. You know, they've been having some success moving the pocket, getting them outside the pocket, and throwing the ball down the field. I think that's what you'll probably see again.
Austin Lumley will have Jake Francis to his left. Two in the backfield. McCann runs to the left, and that low snap going much to his left, and Lumley no choice but to just fall on the ball and take the loss. They'll spot the ball way back now on their territory at the 47-yard line. Second and long, Fratmen. Tyler Story checking into the game now.
You might see that. You might see that isolation play again where they go downtown to Tyler. If you see motion across, you'll probably see Tyler be isolated one-on-one.
Jake Francis will come out for the Fratmen.
That's, yeah, here he comes again. So we're going trips right, and Tyler isolated on 17. You're probably going to see a deep pass here to Tyler.
Three receivers to the right. Lumley looking right. Lumley looking deep, but no one even close. Intercepted by Tim Martin. Tim Martin now running to his right and met up on the play. Excellent tackle there by Tyler Story to make the best of a bad situation. But terrible throw with 28 seconds remaining here in this second quarter.
Number one for Geneva peeled back on that and hit Jacoby Jones so hard his mouth guard actually flew out of his mouth and he had to walk back and pick it up. It was a fantastic block by that young man. These guys are getting after it.
So with 28 seconds left, they'll place the ball on the 35-yard line on the right hash mark. And Geneva, the referees are signaling them to come out, but I don't think the offense was expecting to come out. So we'll see which offense they elect to send out, and it looks like Javid Ellis will be back under center. With Trey Marshall in the backfield. And pitch outside, it's a flea flicker! Wide open on the play is Jamin Evans! And he'll be brought down at close to the 20-yard line. So we've seen a very conservative offense, and then, oh, what the heck, a flea flicker.
If he doesn't underthrow that football, that's probably a touchdown. The young man did a fantastic job coming back and picking it up by down by his feet. Picking it up down by his feet and making a play.
Matt Chamberlain coming out on the play, and it looks like we'll have a timeout here. Not sure who called the timeout. So Geneva can run a more spread offense when they choose to here, Coach.
Well, they still did it out of that same formation, did a little bit of a, you know, a trick play, flea flicker. Again, I'm very surprised that they're staying in that type of offense in this situation in the game, you know, 20, you know, under a minute to go in the game and you got to move the field and you're playing that type of offense.
Mm-hmm. The referee is huddling too. Ball's at about the 22-yard line. As the rain just staving off a bit, a few fans here with their umbrellas out, waiting for the worst in the forecast, but we all know what a weather forecast is good for. Javid Ellis under center. Motion, toss the outside to Jake Olnick. Jake Olnick's got field, he's got corner, he's gone! Touchdown, Geneva College!
That was a little bit of a different setup there. They came back with just a single back. They got rid of the wing backs and spread them out a little bit, and that young man can run. I mean, he got the edge and he was gone.
Jake Olnick helping Geneva College respond on that interception. And here we thought AKO would have a chance to score going into the half, but it is Geneva College with the touchdown. As Noah Wirtz will come in for the extra point.
Yeah, a little bit of a backbreaker. You know, the defense played fantastic there in that middle of a minute and a half, and they got the ball back, and then that turnover cost them.
So the rain's starting to come down now here at Windsor Stadium with 21 seconds remaining. The Geneva College Tornadoes once again take the lead, the third time they've done this in this half, leading the Windsor Fratmen 21-14. Fratmen looking upset and fired up on the sidelines. As we go back to 12-on-12. I'm curious which ball they use when they kick here.
It looks like they actually,
they're going 11-on-11 now.
Might be an American one right now. It looks like it only has half stripes. If you look at the Canadian balls, they use their full white stripe. So I think they're kicking off with an American ball right now.
I never noticed that.
Yeah, definitely that's what it is. It's a little bit smaller as well.
Caught by Jacoby Jones. He'll practice his jukes. And we'll see what they do with 17 seconds and a heck of a lot of field to cover. Austin Lumley and Tyler Story getting some last-minute instructions here. They'll place the ball dead of centers at the 35-yard line. See if they have an answer for a flea flicker here. McCann in the backfield to Lumley's left. Four receivers to his right. Lumley's going to throw it. Going to his left side looking for Demetrius Call, but Call well ahead of the ball and incomplete. It'll be second down with 13 seconds left. We're starting to see footing take apart here, Cloach.
Look like they're trying to, widen them out and spread them out a little bit and get some one-on-one isolation and trying to get it to their athletes to make some plays.
So second down here.
Geneva in a three-man defensive front now, changed it up a tiny little bit and added an extra defensive back.
McCann and Jones in the backfield. Three receivers to Lumley's right. Another low snap. It's just a quick pitch and incomplete. Absolutely no one near Hayes Williams, but hits the ground. Now stop the clock with 9 seconds left. It's third down.
Again, problems with the snap, and it translates into a poor pass over to the wide open wide receiver.
Could possibly be seeing the ball being a little wet too. Lumley known for his accuracy. So he'll get a third opportunity here. Same formation. Just pitches it to the outside, and Jones gets absolutely hit. Big hit on the play.
By Zach Cadillac. Number 21.
So 4 seconds left. This will be the last play of the first half. And since it's Fratmen on offense, we will get one last play. It's a smorgasbord of rules between the Canadian and Americans here today. Lumley, two to his left. Likes to just give it to McCann. McCann ate up at that big line. Some big hosses there by Geneva College. And that will end it for the first half. Trading off of touchdowns by both teams, but it's Geneva College with the last lick. They lead 21-14 over the Windsor Fratmen. When we come back from commercial, we will have the second half. You are watching Windsor Fratmen football here on WeTV.
It's new. It's fresh. It's innovative. It's WeTV, Windsor Essex Television, and you can watch it anywhere. www.we-tv.ca is the place to be. If it's sports, entertainment, or community events, WeTV has what you're looking for. The people, places, and faces of our community are front and center on WeTV. Check out www.we-tv.ca for what's being webcast live. WeTV, we got you covered.
Welcome back here to Windsor Stadium for this special OFC versus NCAA tilt. The Geneva College Tornadoes out of Pennsylvania have a 21-14 lead over the Windsor Fratmen. Brian Thompson, along with the great crew here at WeTV, joined by head coach of the Essex Ravens, Mr. Glenn Mills. And Coach Mills, it's a heck of a first half there. We were seeing a very conservative offense by Geneva College, but the Fratmen kind of moving things along both sides.
You know what? Yeah, a couple of some penalties that kind of stalled the Fratmen a little bit, and a big turnover late in the second half or second quarter that you know, end up giving Geneva the lead. But besides that, the Fratmen are doing some nice things.
Both touchdowns for the Fratmen coming by Tyler Story in the end zone. Two touchdown receptions to his name, Austin Lumley, coming off his back-to-back OFC titles for him. Of course, the club going for their fourth one, but he has the quarterback duties once again today. Just a refresher on the rules here. We are going with Canadian rules when the Fratmen are on offense. And Geneva College will get American rules when they are on offense. We're going four downs both sides. Doesn't matter who's on offense there. As well, there is no yard between. So we look for an exciting second half here. Mark Knight on duties here on the public address announce. Looks like the weather is just clearing up a little bit here. It's supposed to rain off and on. It's been raining pretty much all day here in Windsor, which if anyone who knows Windsor Stadium, it doesn't take much to make the field bad condition. But the field holding up very well here today. Not too many divots in the field, I'd say, especially by Windsor Stadium conditions. It's as good as you can hope for, honestly, in this rainy May. Second half about to be underway. Clark Green will be in for the kickoff. Of course, the team's just doing this for ceremonial purposes and to get their formations in. No contact has been made so far. Up until right around the end, team's starting to get a little testy with each other.
Don't forget, you can catch tonight's game tomorrow. Just log on to www.we-tv.ca and go to their YouTube channel.
Clark Green sets the ball. And a line drive kick taken by Tim Martin. Gets the ball up to about the 25, and then they blow the play dead. So we'll see what the offense here has for Geneva College, scoring late in that quarter off an interception. Touchdown ran in by Brian Stafford. We'll see what their offense can do here. Coach, do you expect to see a few more substitutions made this half to see what other guys can do?
You know what? I'm just looking here. The Geneva coaches, as you said, are right beside us, and they have it all scripted. They got their entire, every series they come out, defensively or offensively, they have it scripted here on who's coming out at every position just to get a look at everybody.
They've been swapping quarterbacks, Geneva College, between Javid Ellis and Devin Koloski. Koloski is under center right now. And he holds on to the ball, fakes it to Marshall, and breaks a few tackles. He's got one more, breaks another tackle, losing his footing a bit, and finally brought down on the play by O.J. Sebega. But what a run there by Devin Koloski.
Again, you know that little inside read there, and he has the option to give it or pull it, and they do a fantastic job with that. And he a couple times, gets his balance back, and he rumbles for quite a few yards.
So first and 10, ball placed get him set. About the 18-yard line here. And it's a pitch to the outside. He's got a few blocks, but brought down on the play there. Nice run there by Colin Kendrick. That'll be another first down here for the Tornadoes.
That's just a quick, little quick pitch outside, and they're just, you know, getting to the edge and turning that thing upfield. The O-line is coming off the football right now. They're getting in the huddle a little bit quicker as well. It's
So first and goal here. Koloski holding onto the ball and just runs it in. Easy touchdown there. And Geneva College takes a two-score lead with 13-17 remaining here in the third quarter. Three plays there, Coach.
Yeah, it was nicely done. Again, same type of look there. He can give it or he can pull it. He end up giving it on the dive. And, you know.
Extra point is up and good. So a two-touchdown lead here now for Geneva College. And we'll see how the Fratmen respond here now. There weren't too many situations last year where they saw themselves down this many scores.
You know, depending on who the Fratmen are substituting, you know, could be causing the problem as well. You got to play every option when you run this type of offense. You got to play the dive. You got to play the quarterback lead. You got to play the option. So if somebody doesn't do their job or do their assignment, it's a big play. As we've seen, you know, 55-yard run by the quarterback.
Geneva College shown they can control inside the hash marks. A lot of their runs so far today by running back Trey Marshall have been all inside handoffs.
Now hopefully they'll show a little bit of wide open stuff. It'd be nice to see if he can come out and do some things, a little bit of spread offense. But right now they're comfortable staying in that single wing.
Noah Wirtz in to kick off here. Austin Crum deep in the backfield for the Fratmen. And a good line kick.
Down to the 5-yard line, that's a real solid kick.
Sends Jacoby Jones, I'm sorry. And they'll blow it dead. And the Fratmen offense will come back. Austin Lumley still at quarterback here. Even an exhibition, though, you want to keep some of your starters out here because there's a lot of pride if you can beat a NCAA team, regardless of the division.
Yeah, I'm not sure who else they got a quarterback right now.
So Lumley will be at shotgun. Two in the backfield. McCann breaks out. Lumley rolls to his right. He's looking deep. Throws deep. It's caught. Well, they rule it in bounds, though. Catch by Demetrius Kaw.
They called it out of bounds.
It is out of bounds.
Nice job again with the Fratmen sealing the edge and getting Austin outside. They're doing a real nice job getting him outside, and he seems to have a lot of success when he gets outside.
So second and 10 here coming up for the Fratmen. Second down. Both touchdowns so far for the Fratmen have been direct response touchdowns to a Geneva touchdown, so we'll see if they can continue that trend. With Lumley in shotgun, empty backfield, rolls to his left. Look for an open receiver, good coverage there. He just hauls it downfield, and that's going to be picked off. Number 15, Joe Shively, almost taking it out of the hands of another defender. Now he waits for some blocks. He's going up the field and gets almost to the center yard mark. That's second interception for Austin Lumley today.
That's a great job by number 15, just playing center field and coming over here and making a fantastic over-the-shoulder interception.
I have to question the throw a bit. With great coverage in downfield there by Geneva College.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Sometimes I think tunnel vision, he just wants to bomb that thing down the field instead of look underneath. You don't have to hit a home run. What they don't understand is whether it's 10 passes or one pass, 7 points or score. So sometimes it's better to go underneath and just make the sure thing.
So two touchdowns and two interceptions so far for Austin Lumley. As nighttime sets in.
You know, this is, we're going to have to get a defensive stand here. This game could quickly start to get out of hand.
Correction, three interceptions. Javid Ellis is now back under center as they continue rotating their quarterbacks in and out. He throws it up the middle, but it's going to be much too low for Trey Marshall.
He does not, this young man, he doesn't seem to throw the ball too well. He can run the football, but he struggles a little bit throwing the ball. AKO has now walked their safeties right in the box. They're playing straight man on the outside receiver. So they got nine guys in the box just tempting them to throw the football here.
Second and 10 here. It's just under 12 minutes in the third quarter.
Yeah, they're walking them right down in the box again, and they're going to play man on the outside, guys. And they're going to bring everybody else.
Trey Marshall, lone man in the backfield. Ellis trying to get around his man, but two men on, fumble, and it's caught by one of his golden guys. It's Brian happening. Stafford, he got the touchdown earlier.
You know, actually,
he rolls out to his left.
A little bit of, I think it was a shovel pass, actually, and the guy coming underneath on it.
It looked like he was falling to the ground. A shovel pass is a generous way to call it. No, I wouldn't say much of a shovel pass. That hit the shoulder of a Fratmen player.
It was just 13 was in the right spot at the right time.
Football Follies, they always look fun on the replays. So a wild and wacky first down there for the Tornadoes. That'll put the ball up on the 39-yard line with 11 minutes to play.
New quarterback, Colossi's back in the game here.
So now they're not even waiting for change of possessions to shuffle quarterbacks. Tight inside. Koloski with the handoff. And Trey Marshall ate up in the backfield for second down. Gets about 2 yards on the play there. Or one. With the way the dollar is going, we don't know what the difference will be. Coach Morency for the Fratmen, shouting in some instructions.
Got number 7, Javid Ellis is back in a quarterback. Popping him every play, apparently.
It's pretty hard to coach when you don't know who's going to be quarterback play after play. And just ate up in the backfield. A great job by the Fratmen.
Yeah, the Fratmen right now are bringing everybody. They got 11 guys in there. They got 9 guys in the box, and they're blitzing.
Chris Grondin, main man on the tackle there on that team effort. They say it's 3rd and 9, closer to 10.
And they're gonna stay. They're gonna stay in this offense.
The stubborn Tornadoes. Now it is a pass.
This guy
wide open. And caught. We've been looking all day for Jameen Evans, who's been lining up all by himself. Finally gets a throw to him, makes a great catch, and a first down.
Hey, this young man's a big, tall, looks like a pretty good-looking athlete, and just is wide open down the field. And Javid Ellis does a great job delivering a football. That's probably the best way to go.
The first catch of the day for Jameen Evans.
About the 9-yard line here, so I don't think they can get a first down.
Javid Ellis still in at quarterback. That's 2 in a row. Hands off to Trey Marshall. Trey Marshall runs right up the middle for a touchdown.
You know, this young man is a very, very solid inside runner. Does a great job of just hitting that hole. And he's you know, 5-6 yards downfield before anybody pops through there, and away he goes.
Third straight touchdown here for the Tornadoes.
Those turnovers right now are costly, as this game is you know, very close to kind of getting out of hand here, and it's simply because of turnovers.
No, Wirtz punts in the extra point. So with 9:04 remaining here in the third quarter, as nightfall sets here at Windsor Stadium, Geneva College leading 35-14 over the Windsor Fratmen. Want to remind everyone here, of course, we will have the Fratmen schedule underway as they kick off in late August, as always, and looking for their 4th straight OFC championship. If memory serves, this is the last season where the OFC isn't as much a part of the CJFL.
Next year, I think that's going to change a little bit, right? And they're jumping back into the CGFL. The age limit's going to drop one more year, and that'll be a great opportunity for those kids to compete on a national level.
Kick by Noah Wirtz. Line drive kick. And just a quick little jog there for Austin Crum. And the Fratmen will take back over. Well, Austin Lumley, he threw a lot of interceptions last year on the way to another title. He's got three so far here today. We'll see if he can find his footing out there.
Hopefully he just comes out and, again, you know, you did a fantastic job at times managing managing the offense, and sometimes you want to go for that home run and you don't have to.
Hayes Williams, the lone receiver to his left. Play action. As once again, the deep ball. But boxed out of the play is Jake Francis. Good job there by Joe
again.
Shively.
15 again, almost picking that thing off. He's a ball hawk. He's flying around the field making some plays.
That'll bring up second and 10 here for the Fratmen. And you can see Jake Francis out there going, what am I supposed to do?
It doesn't look like they're running too many underneath routes. They just want to bomb this thing down the field. I mean, they gotta come underneath and pick him apart a little bit. I move the pocket. He's much better when he moves the pocket because he has an option to run, and Austin's pretty good at that.
Lumley back in shotgun with McCann on his right side. Once again, another deep ball, but he overthrows his receiver, DeGos.
Got number six, Omar Hayes-Williams, sitting in the flats, 10 yards downfield, nobody near him, and you know they're just trying to push this thing down the field. Again, you can't get back in the game with one long pass. It's only 7 points regardless of, you know, what you do. So you got to pick away and control the clock and just get back in this thing.
It's almost like playing your little brother in Madden where they just want to keep going downfield.
Well, it's tough now. You're third and 10. You're in a tough situation. You almost have to pass the football. You know, they're going to pin their ears back. They're only playing a three-man front right now. They're playing extra DBs.
Hayes Williams,
pass.
Hayes Williams alone on the left side. Lumley, empty backfield with a flag on the play. And once again, going deep, looking to the sidelines. Intercepted again. Harrison Coslow. We'll see what the flag's on. The flag's on the Fratmen, so that'll be declined. And man, oh man. Just overthrowing Hayes Williams by about 5 feet.
Standing back there and just firing this thing down the field is not working. They had some fantastic success moving him out of the pocket and getting him in some, you know, getting him some space and let him make some decisions. I think they got to get back to rolling the pocket, moving the pocket, and do things like that.
I can't even remember the last running play.
Well, I tell you one thing. This defensive line for Geneva is doing a pretty good job taking away the run, but they had fantastic success the first half playing, doing play action. They've got away from play action. They're just standing back in a pocket, bombing this thing down the field. And again, it's 3-4 picks now, and they're going to be in tough times here in a minute if they drive the field down now.
Devin Koloski will be your quarterback du jour for the Tornadoes. A quick handoff to Trey Marshall as he fights his way back to the line of scrimmage. Good job on the takedown there by number 57, Joe Joynson. And I'll bring up second down.
See, they've had much more success running that thing inside. He wanted to bounce that outside. And they're far better popping it inside.
They rolled second and 9 with just under 7 minutes left.
AKO again got everybody up in the box, and then they're just tempting them to throw the football.
Jamin Evans, the lone receiver.
Here they come.
And it's Trey Marshall taking it inside, and he'll get right to that first down marker up the field. Great job by Trey Marshall. And they roll it. Yep, it's a first down. So the ball will be placed at the 52-yard line. Geneva scoring touchdowns in each of their last three possessions.
They are definitely dominating the line of scrimmage right now. This O-line's rolling, and
roll out there by Kowalski. He gets Jake Olnick. Jake Olnick running up the sidelines, and nobody's going to catch him. Touchdown, Geneva College. They're fourth in as many possessions, and this game's starting to get a little bit out of hand.
It's a great job. They set up Jake and leak him out of the backfield. He sets up like he's going to pass block, and they leak him out of the backfield out into the flats, and then he just turns on the afterburners. And I think they're saying he stepped out of bounds, but he's nowhere near the sideline.
No.
I mean, he is probably, you know, a yard inside the sidelines. But the AKO players were pointing that he stepped out of bounds. Nowhere near out of bounds.
Extra point taken by the other seven, Noah Wirtz. Up and good, so 42-14. What was once a trade-off of touchdowns in a close game is now exploded into a four-touchdown differential. At least the skies have stayed clear tonight.
It's a beautiful day in the neighborhood.
In the backfield for the Fratmen, we have Jacoby Jones, as well as Austin Crum. Haven't seen a lot in terms of substitutions that way, especially special teams.
Hopefully, you know what, they'll come out and they'll try and establish a little bit of the run game and try and settle this thing down, because right now they are definitely out of rhythm and out of sorts. And knowing these U.S. guys, you know, they don't let up. Their blood's in the water, and they're going to keep coming.
Caught there by Austin Crum.
Oh, we got an early whistle here, but that's
irrelevant almost.
It is. Yeah, it's just
they'll put it up to the 35. So the Fratmen running out of time and running out of chances here.
Again, right now, you know what? I'm not sure you're trying to win the football game more than you are just trying to get your offense rolling and establish. Mm-hmm. You know, get some good things happening.
But that's what they want to see, right?
And get a look at things. Right now, it's like they're trying to win the game and they're just going to bomb this thing down the field. Which
Austin Lumley now out of the game. That's Brandon Rehm in a quarterback. Pass completed. And getting up to the first down is Ben DeGoss.
Again, a quick little pass where they come out and quick pass in the flats, and then they deliver this, and then he picks it up, a 3-4 yard run.
So the quarterback change, one throw, one completion.
Brennan as well is a fantastic runner. He's got some great speed, so you know, he can do a lot of things that Austin can do, get outside the pocket and different things like that.
Empty backfield. He looks to his left. Pass caught by Jake Francis. Stiff arms his way up into about the 52-yard line, and it'll be second down.
You know, it's funny to watch this. You see it right now. The ball was on the far hash, and they're throwing the an 8-yard. 8-yard pass to the flats. It's about a 45-yard pass.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's a far pass for, you know, a 6-7, 8-yard gain.
Ball's on the 51-yard line.
So they rule it second and four here in this third quarter.
They're playing way off. Usually, you know, if they're playing within 5 yards, that pass isn't going to be delivered because that's a pick six every time you throw that thing. The corner's way off.
Ben DeGoss way out on the right side by himself. Two receivers to Rehm's left. Now they break out a bit. Rehm looking to his right, scrambles, rolls. Flag on the play, looks like a hold. Rehm more than enough for the first down, getting out of bounds. Good tackle on the play there by Zach Kadelic. But it looks like this is coming back.
Now again, here's what we talked about again,
yeah.
Right? They don't do a fantastic job maintaining the edge. I think the, you know, defensive tackles than they are defensive ends. And Brandon gets outside, Oh, yeah, it's definitely a hold. It's, you know, I mean, I think it's probably going on 67.
Motaba Mary.
But again, with a two-man rush, you guys know the most athletic guys to keep this quarterback inside the pocket. And, you know, anytime Brandon or Austin wants to run, it's there. And I don't think they're utilizing it to the best of their ability.
So second and 20 for the Frat. As Riam will go with two receivers on each side. Jones in the backfield, goes out to his right. Riam once again with the pass, going to his right. Quick little pass, caught there. And I'd say about a gain of 17 on the play there, Ben DeGoss.
Now, as you see, they're playing a little bit tighter now. They're locked up on him. This easily could have been very close. You know, when it picked off, the guy was a couple steps behind, but they're sitting on this.
3:10 remaining here in this third quarter. Sticking with the same formation. Two receivers on each side for Riam. Flag on the play as this is aired way out over everyone's head, but I think we're going to have an offside call here on the Fratmen. We have a man down as well. Number 30, Vinny Chirapa. And yeah, he's face down on the ground. That can't be good.
Now, if you take a look, they're leaking their running back out a little bit earlier, and he's kind of going up the seam. And nobody's picking him up. Like, they got a linebacker that's lined up against him, and they're just letting him run down the middle of the field.
Okay, so while we wait to see what happens, we will take a timeout here. 42-14.
It's new, it's fresh, it's innovative, it's WeTV, Windsor Essex Television, and you can watch it anywhere. www.we-tv.ca is the place to be. If it's sports, entertainment, or community events, WeTV has what you're looking for. The people, places and faces of our community are front and center on WeTV. Check out www.we-tv.ca for what's being webcast live. WeTV, we got you covered. It's new, it's fresh, it's innovative, it's WeTV, Windsor Essex Television, and you can watch it anywhere. www.we-tv.ca is the place to be. If it's sports, entertainment, or community events, WeTV has what you're looking for. The people, places, and faces of our community are front and center on WeTV. Check out www.we-tv.ca for what's being webcast live. WeTV, we got you covered.
Welcome back here to Windsor Stadium. Brian Thompson, Glenn Mills, and the entire WeTV team here. Leg injury looking to defensive lineman DeMarcus Ware here for the Fratmen. As you see, he's helped off by teammates, landing pretty hard on that, and that's very unfortunate to see. We hope he's well. You never want to see an exhibition game take anyone's health. So now we will get back to football, though. So Geneva College not taking the penalty there on the hold. So it'll be fourth down, or third rather. It's exhibition for everybody. Riam to his right, and it's been the same play mostly, constantly hitting Ben DeGoss.
You know, it's the same thing. Short side of field now with a much more high percentage pass, and he's just getting to the first down marker and turning this thing upfield and just playing for the first down, which is fantastic job managing the offense and moving the change, which is the most important thing.
That's about the fourth time they've gone to DeGoss. And that'll be a fresh set of downs here for the Fratmen. It'll be three receivers to the left of Ream. At his side is Kyle Watson in now for the game. Ream going deep. He's got a receiver, but just overthrows his man, Omar Hayes-Williams, by about, I'd say, 5 feet. And it'll be second and 10.
Again, just a lot of vertical routes, and they just moved down the field here, going, you know, 8 yard outs and 8 yard hooks, and they come back to bombing it down the field.
So just over a minute here remaining in this third quarter. Geneva with a commanding 4-touchdown lead. But the Fratmen offense starting to roll again, as it looked in the first half. Same formation out. Ream stays short side, but well over the head of Jake Francis, who had absolutely nobody near him. And that'll be third down. No one inside of him, Coach.
Yeah, it's just wide receiver screen, and he overthrows him. Just got to open up and fire that thing. And
time for just a couple more plays here in this quarter. Ream, two men at his side. He runs to his left, gets a good block. But absolutely drilled, number 45. We don't have a 45 on our roster here. But that'll be fourth down. What a hit.
You know, playing downhill, and he's getting after guys.
So good sack by Mystery Man there. And that brings an end to a third quarter. It'll be 42-14 as we start this fourth quarter here. We're not going to take a break. We're just going to keep this going. And I think that's the way Coach LaChance would want it right now.
Yeah.
Not too much has gone right this second half.
So Geneva again playing a three-man front and still getting a lot of pressure with a three-man front, which is definitely, you know, going to cause some concern for Coach LaChance when he watches this film.
Clark Green would be more than happy to just punt this one away. I haven't seen that many people stand around the line of scrimmage since junior high school football. So they'll stop this play dead. And the ball will be spotted at the 35. As we see the injury being taken care of for DeMarcus Ware. They focus on his leg.
Sponsors for tonight's game, Windsor Honda, Explosive Sports Performance.
Certainly hope he's okay. You got a couple months until the season starts, but still.
Windsor Essex Television. Greater Essex County District School Board. St. Clair College Sinks Athletics. Not a source for sports.
And it looks like another quarterback in, and now it's Brian Stafford, who's ran in for a couple touchdowns. Now he's under center. This Geneva College team, rich in quarterbacks, gain up one there.
Well, you know, with the way the offense is run, you can move different guys in there. And, you know, if you're a decent athlete, you can come in, run this quarterback spot, depending on what you want to do. I'm very surprised that they haven't got out of this offense and been a little bit more experimental in an exhibition game. I mean, it's the game really doesn't mean a whole lot. I'm surprised they're not white, you know, winging this thing around and just doing some things.
So Stafford will go back under center. Split receivers on each side. Looks like they're lining up offside on the right side, though. But it doesn't matter, and they rush up for about another 2 yards on the play. It'll be third down.
Yeah, it's a new fullback in there as well. David Rubis is getting his opportunity to carry the ball a little bit.
A couple substitutions now as David Rubis comes out.
Yeah, it looks like the quarterback went out and Rubis went out. They might be bringing in a little bit of wholesale changes here for backfield.
Stafford still in at quarterback.
Oh, yeah, he did come back in.
He's got Kyle Burgess as his only receiver to his left. That empty backfield. Just an inside handoff there. And Geneva just keeping it simple, but that's going to get them to a fourth down here.
They do have option in that opportunity as well, and the option was wide open. They weren't really playing the option very well there.
Austin Crum back deep along with Tyler Story.
I think they were going to go for it there for a minute, and now they decided to punt this away.
It's interesting. Again, we're sitting next to the Geneva College coach sidelines. All these kickoffs and punts have been largely ceremonial and stuff. They take them very, very seriously. Big, high, deep kick taken all the way back to the 40-yard line.
That's a real nice job there. That was probably his best punt of the night.
So Tyler Story will get the ball for them at the 40-yard line with 12-10 remaining here in the fourth quarter. So they're going to stick with Brandon Ream at quarterback now?
You know what, I think so. I think you're probably going to get an opportunity to see, you know, check out Brandon and watch how he plays. And I'm sure Austin's their guy, and he's going to be their guy come the season. But you always got to have the, you know, next man up, so he's going to get his opportunity to play in a game situation.
Ram with
basic offense, going trips right here, pistol backfield.
Ram will look to his right, sets. Excellent catch there by Jones, but a big shoulder hit there by Tim Martin, and that'll be about a gain of 8.
He's going to block the edge. He leaks out of the backfield, and he just dumps it in there. You know, for a nice little 8-yard gain.
Ball's on the 52-yard line. Second down.
In hockey, a hit like that's good for 5. But thank goodness this is football. Two receivers to his right. Reams. Movement. He looks to his left. Throws up the middle. Another catch there. Great catch by Hayes Williams coming up the side on the streak. And that'll be down at the 38-yard line for a first down Fratmen.
That's a great call. A little bit of a cover 3 look. Trying to take away those quick 8-yard passes to the flats. And now they just hit him right in the hole.
Tackle made on the play by Austin Jacobson of Geneva.
They're just waiting for the half to vacate. And then they're going to sit down in there and pick that apart.
Kyle Watson now subbing out. For the Fratmen. As they stick with 3 receivers to the right side of Ream. Demetrius Kaw, the lone receiver to the left. Ream throwing and off footing there is Jones.
That's same play they ran about 3 plays ago. They're rolling their half up now and he's taking away the flats, and as soon as Jacoby turns around, you'll see him sitting here. And he's right there, bang. They're taking away that little flat pass.
Zach Kalechik on the hit there. That'll bring up 2nd and 10. As we're under 10 minutes left here in the fourth quarter. Of course, exhibition, even if there is a great comeback, I wouldn't imagine there's any overtime tonight. Movement by Hayes Williams to the right side. Rehm throwing to his left. He's got wide open Kaw. And Kaw getting right to the pylon. That'll be close to a first down.
Again, they brought that guy across the position right there. Got backside isolation one-on-one. He just runs a quick stop route and picks up.
Tackle made on the play by either Noah Wirtz or Javid Ellis.
That's a real nice job, you know, in managing, again, managing the downs to get yourself a first down.
So the Fratmen taking their time, setting this up. Getting their practice in. Now they load up their receivers to the left of Rehm. Call alone on the right side. Or no, I'm sorry, that's DeGoss. And DeGoss holding onto the ball, juggling a little bit there. He'll go down at about the 25-yard line. That'll be a gain of four. And it'll be second down for the prep.
Again, same play. They're just, you know, quick flat pass and trying to get the yard back to catch.
Second down here for him. Kaw now all by himself on the left side of the field. Being
tripped short side and trying to isolate Kaw on the backside here.
And the first run we've seen in a while. Being taken by.
They gained nothing. I mean, they're only playing a three-man front defensively, and they cannot run the football against this three-man front.
So it'll be second down and nine, or third rather. They're saying third and five. Be a pass here for Rehm, but he looks to just run it himself. He's got enough for the first down, making a couple jukes, looking for a block, going at the left side, making another move. He's still on his feet. Touchdown, Fratmen! What an effort by Brandon Rehm.
Those are the things that Brandon brings to the table.
Let's count the guys here that Rehm Dukes. There's one. Gets two, and he's got the ball way to the outside. There's the third, bouncing off Tim Martin, and then going for the pylon. He gets it beautifully. What an effort by Rehm.
He's a fantastic athlete. I was fortunate enough to coach him at Ravens and seen a lot of that, those things happen when he played for us.
So with just under 7 minutes remaining here in the fourth quarter, the Fratmen back on the board. Geneva College, though, leads 42-21 here on WeTV. Of course, mind you, check out we-tv.ca for all the latest games. Of course, we have Windsor Clippers lacrosse coming up. Some great baseball action this summer. The action will not stop. Check it out one more time here, Coach.
Brandon pulls it down. He was supposed to pass the ball. He pulls it down and again does what he does well and utilizes his feet and his athletic ability. And
especially on that wet field, impressive to keep his bearings. Of course, it's beating a dead horse talking about the turf at Windsor Stadium, but when you can do it after it's been raining all day, that's a feather on your cap. So Clark Green in to kick off. 6:59 remaining here in the fourth quarter. Really nice kick to about the 8-yard line. Clark Green, no complaints about him today.
No, he's a strong leg guy. He's a fantastic punter as well. And I know he had a very solid season here last year playing for AKO.
Remind everyone, Saturday, the action continues here on WeTV. A rare visit by Six Nations in the Ontario Junior B Lacrosse League as they take on the Windsor Clippers at Forest Glade Arena. We will have all the coverage here for you on we-tv.ca. So tune in and check us out as the Junior B Lacrosse season gets underway and all the good summer action here on WeTV. Under center is Brian Stafford, and he just goes with the quick handoff. I believe it was Jalen Ansell on the carry there, and he got about 3 yards on the play for second down. So it'll be second and 7. As they continue to make a couple adjustments here. Brian Stafford still in at quarterback here. He's got 2 rushing touchdowns to his name so far today. Kyle Burgess, the lone running back. And he's just eating up at the line. Might have gained 2 there, and it'll be 3rd down, coach.
Yeah, again, Fratmen bringing some pressure. Bringing guys to the body. Very difficult. Things don't remember at the point of attack.
Oh, Stafford kept the ball, rather. Very deceptive with those handoffs right at the line of scrimmage.
That's the great advantage in soccer. The wing, it's very difficult to do a lot of different things.
Larry Blocker checks into the game for the Fratmen. As they keep it close to the line here. Mario Ricci in at corner. It is 3rd and 5 now. Stafford outside pitch. And a heck of a lane open there. That's Colin Kendrick. And he races up the sidelines for a huge gain into Fratmen territory with under 5 minutes remaining.
You know, that's the problem when you walk everybody. You walk everybody in the box, take away that little dive and inside run, and they hit him on a little bit of a power, a quick pitch, and this guy gets outside. They just seal the edge, and this guy gets outside, and he's gone. That's a 30, 40-yard gain on a simple quick pitch.
Tackle made on the play there by Dante Parnicero. The clock continues to move with about 4:20 left here. Stafford, who's kept it under center pretty much his entire time at quarterback. Play it tight. And he does make the handoff, and that's good for almost the first down. Good play there by Jalen Ansell.
He just came in this series, and he's a big kid. He's a big, thick kid. He's going to run that inside stuff, that quick dive and pop, and he runs it hard.
They say the fullback's a dying art, coach.
I love the fullback. It's, especially a young man that size. He's a big bruiser.
The days of the Mike Allstotts and the Corey Schlesingers. It's good to see that position still around. Ball placed on the 25-yard line towards the right side. Ansel's lone back, 2 receivers to the right. See if Stafford elects to keep it. Stafford holds on to it, and he's just eaten up in the backfield. Good read there by Adam Chin. Waiting. Adam Chin waited patiently here and got the sack.
Changes of play here, and AKO does a great job. Great job adjusting to it. And Adam comes underneath the down block and makes a fantastic play on the quarterback.
Assist there to Robert Dundara. And we have the 3-minute warning. We're inside 3 minutes. as they get some last minute instructions from the out from the sidelines here. Geneva College is going to be very happy on their trip home. Great effort by them. Six touchdowns by their offense. Not to mention four interceptions by their defense.
We have to have a timeout. Here, broke the huddle and guys didn't know which side of the football they were going to.
So, excellent effort by Geneva today. Tornadoes, of course, their season will start up in September when they begin Division III play out in the President's Athletics Conference. Of course, we wish them all the best, and I'm sure people in the Windsor area will be a little bit of a closer eye on some Division III football, see if how they do in their season.
And don't forget, you can catch tonight's game tomorrow.
So 2:26 on the clock here. If there's one thing we can be grateful tonight, the weather has actually held up very nicely. We've seen it spit a little bit today during the game. It rained most of the day, but for Windsor Stadium, all the dry weather they can get really helps. Ryan Stafford's still in at quarterback. Second and 10 here for the Tornadoes. He rolls out to his left looking for a receiver. Well covered though, he's got a rush, get by. Stafford running and finally taken out of bounds there by Dante Fornacero.
This young man can play football. He does a fantastic job. He eludes rolls out of the pocket and he does a great job eluding some tackles here. He gets out in the open field and he can make some moves. I mean, he's not afraid to play, to run the ball great pickup.
Always good when you can watch your quarterback get something out of absolutely nothing. Good job there by the secondary for the Fratmen plugging up all the receivers. But it doesn't matter, it's a first down here. First and 10, ball placed on the 14-yard line. Single receiver to the right. Stafford, handoff inside, rushing in, touchdown!
The big
Geneva
man there,
College.
Again.
Once again, Jalen Ansell, who has been tremendous this drive, gets in the end zone, and it is 48-21.
It's funny, this young man, he can change his jersey. He probably put a 60 number on him. He might be an offensive guard. But, you know, he did a great job finding the end zone, and the boys are there to beat him. It was nice.
Another rushing touchdown here for the Tornadoes with a minute 47 remaining here in the fourth quarter. And that puts a cap on an excellent day here by the Tornadoes at Windsor Stadium.
You know, you might be able to count the passes by this team, I think, on for sure your two hands, but you might even be able to count them on one hand, and they put 48 points up. That's a solid effort by the offensive line today.
49-21 in favor of Geneva College.
So the Fratmen, possibly at the last drive here.
I was close. I was just informed that they passed the ball seven times. I thought it was around five, but again, 49 points. It's a solid effort by the offensive line.
Of course, we want to thank our statisticians here today for assisting us with the coverage, as well as our cameramen braving it up here at Windsor Stadium, as well as all the great guys in the truck. And of course, the help by both the Fratmen and Geneva preparing for this game today. We'll have plenty more of football as the weather turns a bit colder later in the year. Some people aren't in a rush for it, but football fans certainly are. Kickoff at the 40 here by, we believe, Noah Wirtz. And Austin Crum will take that back at the 10-yard line. And the Fratmen will get another drive. So Brandon Ream will lead out the Fratmen once again.
The ball is marked on the Fratmen's 35-yard line. First down.
So minute 47 here. We'll see if they can, the Fratmen can get one last score here to cap off this night. About 100 people in attendance, I'd say, tonight, Coach Mills. Pretty good crowd for May.
I'm inside. I'm nice and dry. It's exactly where I like to be.
Catch made there by DeGoss. Might have got a couple yards on the play here, and it'll be second down.
No, back to that, again, back to that quick little flat pass that, you know, that he goes, picks up 5-6 yards. High percentage pass.
So it'll be second and five here. As we're just under 100 seconds. They go with quad receivers, two on each side. Reem giving some last-minute instructions to his backs. Crum rolls out. Reem looking deep to his left. Catch by Hayes Williams, and then it bounces out of his hands and out. That's one of those ones you'll be thinking about later, Coach.
Right in a little soft spot here. This should have been a catch. You know, Omar usually makes those.
Right on the collarbone. Austin Crum will come out of the game. It'll be third and five here now for the Fratmen. Ball placed on the right hash mark here. They go with three receivers to their right. Geneva College playing a bit deeper. Single receiver to the left of Reem. He's looking that way. Now he looks right. Rolls out to his right, being chased. And he elects to run it. Goes out. But he's going to be close to that first down. He might have got it. And see what they award here. Yeah, they awarded it. It's a first down.
First down, Fratmen.
Just enough there. They place the ball on the 47-yard line. 40 seconds remaining here in this fourth quarter. Fratmen smashed three receivers to the right. Hayes Williams alone on the left side. Reem looking towards Hayes Williams. And a big hit. No, I'm sorry, that's Demetrius Kaw.
You know, there's
that was 40, timed perfectly.
There's that 45-yard pass. You're throwing from the far hash across the field. I mean, that's a tough pass in the CFL, let alone at this level. You got 10 minutes to break on the football. Not a high percentage play, that's for sure.
That'll bring up second and 10 here. They send two receivers to the left, Hayes Williams and Kaw. Fratmen wanting to make sure they get in every little piece of this game they can. With 13 seconds left, they call timeout. Well, Coach, what have your impressions been of this little exhibition tilt?
You know what, I thought the Geneva team I don't know how much they practice, but usually they don't play football till you know, August. But you know what? I thought their fakes and their handoffs were outstanding. Mm-hmm. I thought their offensive line did a fantastic job coming off the football. And I thought that defensive line-wise, they're a very, very stout football team. And, you know, AKO did some nice things. You know, I think they got to find what they do well and, you know, just work those or – I thought when they moved the pocket around and got outside the pocket, they utilized all their talent. And, you know, I think that those are some highlights you'll take out of this game.
Enough time for a couple more plays here left in the game. We'll see what's left on the play sheet for the Fratmen. Reem in shotgun now with two men in the backfield. Play action, rolling out to his right. Gets a block, now rolls out to his left. Good blocks there. Gets back to the line of scrimmage. He's going to keep it. He's going to try and run through some men as time expires. And that'll do it. A good run by Brandon Reem to end the game. Geneva College, though, they are the victors here. A 49-21 victory for Geneva College over the Windsor Fratmen. Want to remind everyone, stay with us this weekend. The Windsor Lacrosse, Windsor Clippers lacrosse team, they will be taking on the Six Nations. We will have action on Saturday for you. On behalf of myself, Coach Glenn Mills, Dominic Papa, and the rest of the WeTV crew here, this is Brian Thompson saying thank you for tuning in, and we'll see you all really soon. Thank you very much.